see you today here at service. Welcome to Redeemer's Church. Hey, if this is your first time here, I'd like to invite you to fill out the communication card that you can find just right under the seat in front of you. You can fill it out and turn it in at the offering receptacles on your way out after service, or you can drop it off at the information center, which is at the gazebo outside in the quad area. And if you turn it in there, you will get a Redeemer's Church mug and also a voucher for a Missio Dei coffee. You can also find the form online at redeemerschurch.com/new. If you take a screenshot of that form, you can show the barista at Missio Dei and you will also get a free drink. We also have a Redeemer's Church app and you can download that right now if you have not already done so. Just head to redeemerschurch.com and right on the homepage, just scroll down and there's a link for you to download the app there. With the app, you will be able to follow along with today's sermon notes, check out the events going on throughout the week, and you can also give online at any time. And some other ways that we have for you to give at your convenience are the offering receptacles located at the front entrance of the worship center, or you can utilize our text to give feature. Again, we are also grateful that you are joining us this morning.
What's up, Redeemer's family? It's your boy, Edgar, and I have some cool news for all of you. November 17th and November 21st is gonna be a chill week. Why? Well, November 17th, middle school, we are gonna go bowling at Dinuba Orbit Lanes from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Please remember to bring $10 to cover the expenses for shoes and an hour of bowling. You can meet us here at the church at 5:30 p.m. to catch a ride with your adult leaders, or meet us there at Dinuba Orbit Lanes at 6 p.m. High schoolers, we are heading to Adventure Park in Visalia on November 21st. That'll take place from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Same thing applies. Please bring $20 to cover the expenses for the attractions at the park. Also, meet us here at 4 p.m. in the parking lot to catch a ride with us adult leaders, or meet us there at 5 p.m. on the dot. We're super excited for all this to take place. A little chill vibes happening. You know what it is. Come on down.
Good morning, Redeemers. My name is Maribel, and I'm here to tell you that we will be having a swap meet on November 12th, Redeemers Remate, from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. Redeemers Church is always looking for ways to serve our community. So at the Remate, we will have several service booths where people can find access to different nonprofits, different services. We will also have goods for sale. This is a perfect way for us to get to know the community, for people to get to know Redeemers Latino and serve Readly. There are several ways that you can support this event. You can sign up to set up, clean up, help us direct traffic, or you can sign up to have your own booth. If you'd like to sign up to serve, contact me at maribel@servereadly.org. If you'd like to host a booth and sell some goods, come to the office and fill out our application. Or if you simply just like to come and enjoy the food, music, and fellowship, please do so. See you at the Remate.
Would you like to take the next step in your faith? Then we have the perfect opportunity for you to do so on November 14th because we are holding baptisms. If you are new to faith, if you've been growing in your faith and feeling like this is the next step for you, then we would love to come alongside you and support you as you get baptized. So again, November 14th at our 10 a.m. service right here, we'll be holding baptisms. Head over to redeemerschurch.com/hub and get signed up today.
Good morning, Redeemers. Morning. Y'all ready for the word?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
All right. Let's get going. Hey, I'm not going to do a reading today because it is super long and we would be here for like 10 minutes reading the next two chapters. But I am going to tell you where they're at. I encourage you to write it down. I encourage you to read the scriptures for yourself. We are telling stories all the way starting from chapter 16 of Acts, verse 23, all the way to 18, verse 8. So I'm going to be covering this large span of stuff. I'm going to give you a rundown of what's going on in each as I talk today. But so for you to reference and look at and know what we're talking about, it's right there, starting in chapter 16 all the way to 18:8. You know, the last week, this is a part two to last week. So if you weren't here last week, try to grab last week's sermon. For those who are new, welcome. This might be, I'm going to try to catch you up as much as I can. But we've been in this series, Hard Knocks. We've been talking about how you start this journey of faith, you look at the book of Acts, and as soon as this church starts growing and all these exciting things are happening, much like when you and I start in faith, there begins to be all these things where all these hardships come about, these persecutions, these failures, these divisions in people's lives. But we're in this section of Acts where Paul is seeing these he's not just sharing with a bunch of people about his faith, he's actually meeting individuals along the way, and he's seeing them come to faith, but he does it uniquely and differently in so many different ways. Last week I shared about the five different methods that I can see in these chapters where it talks about it shows us individuals on how they came to Christ, and they're all unique and different. Five approaches to sharing your faith, and here's what I said. It was commending, confronting, comforting, culture crossing, and conceding. Now, last week we covered commending and confronting, and what we talked about is, you know, everybody probably, in fact, there are people in this room probably still struggling with their faith, and then there's people who you have a strong faith, but you're surrounded by people who don't share that you love. Maybe it's in your family, maybe it's friends, whatever it might be, there's people you love, and you're like, how do I talk about this? Last week I made everybody very uncomfortable, and I asked you to share the gospel with one another in an awkward way. Were you feeling uncomfortable? Come on, I saw y'all. Were you uncomfortable? Yeah, that's here where you're being forced in church to do it. Imagine how uncomfortable everybody is IRL in real life. I'm getting down and hip, right, teens? Just kidding. But that's the point, right? And what I brought up last week is that Jesus Christ himself commands that we become witnesses to his name to others. It is a command on us, not a suggestion, not for a select few. It's those who know me should share about me, should let others know that this is the most important thing in the world, that they're the only means to finding true salvation in the world is through Christ. It's a command, and yet most people don't do it, and I sat there and told you, I understand. It is awkward, it is difficult, it is hard, and mostly we've seen it done poorly, where there's a cookie cutter method where you go up and you say the same thing to people. And what we talked about last week is, you know what, there's actually different ways. There's one gospel that Jesus Christ died for the sins of the world, that he was resurrected to bring new life and eternal life to those who believe in him. There is one gospel, but man, there are so many different shades to it of how you can present it to people in ways that intersect with what God is doing in their life. Last week we talked about commending, which was welcoming somebody in that you see goodness in them. They just don't know Christ, but they have a hunger for God. They might have these things God has placed in them that they do well, and you can affirm them and say, wow, that's so great. Would you come join me and walk with me in this faith thing that we're doing? And you invite them. Then we talked about confronting. We got into talking about hell and some of those things. When is it appropriate to talk about that? And is it always? And it was it was fun for me. Is it fun for you? It was interesting. This week, I want to look at three other ways in which you might talk to somebody. I'm only going to spend a very little time on comforting and conceding. Our big focus today is going to be on culture crossing. But I will tell you the story of where I get comforting from. In chapter 16, Paul has just, we talked about it last week, he had just freed this girl from slavery and in possession of this evil spirit, and because he messed with somebody's money, they tried to get him in prison. You know, she had these slave owners, so he was thrown into prison because many of the believers were thrown into prison because they had taken this woman and freed her and brought her to Christ and freed her from this economic slavery she was in. As well as from the spirit that was in her. So now they're in prison. And if you know the story, it's a pretty famous story, but Paul is sitting there singing hymns and praying to God when he is on trial here. He is chained inside this prison, and there's this big earthquake, and the gates open up, his chains fall off, and when it all transpires, he doesn't run away. But the guard doesn't know that. The guard was put in charge of making sure all these prisoners stayed put. And if they got away, the guard would be killed. And so the guard goes to take his own life because he's like, I've lost all the prisoners. And he's going. And this is the guy who is helping imprison Paul. He's an enemy. But Paul stays put. And he ends up saying, no, we are all here. Don't harm yourself. Don't kill yourself. This is the first point. He brings this guy to Christ, and here's how he does it. It's comforting. Comforting consists of two things. It's you can comfort people with sacrificial grace or with patience and presence. Now, sacrificial grace is a lot like forgiveness. There are people who don't deserve your help because they have hurt you or harmed you, spoken poorly of you, made life harder on you, and yet the ability to showcase Christ and share Christ with somebody may come down to your ability to stand there and go, I'm not going to do what you expect me to do, though you deserve it. You know that? Though you deserve my anger, though you deserve my lawsuit, though you deserve whatever it might be, I'm still here, and I can extend forgiveness. This man is so captured by Paul's graciousness, his sacrificial grace. Paul could have run away. He did nothing wrong. He deserved to be outside of prison. He could have run away. He stayed put so that he could comfort this guy in need. Here's what it says. It says, the jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors, in verse 27 of chapter 16, when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. And Paul shouted, don't harm yourself. We are all here. He then brought them out and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. How do you get the ear of somebody whose job it is to mistreat you, who rejects Christ, whose job it is to be a jerk, to imprison you, to do things that are against you? How do you get the ear to share Christ in that circumstance? If anybody deserves a conversation on hell, it'd be this guy, right? You're chaining me up. But Paul sees a different approach on this one. He says, don't harm yourself. He sacrifices his own freedom for this guy to not have to kill himself, and says, we are all here. I would add, we are all here for you is an amazing statement as a Christian. We are all here for you. That's the second part of comfort. It's patience and presence. You know, how many people in your life, family members, have hurt you, have disrespected you, have not done what you've required? And you know, some of the times the best ways to display Christ and the forgiveness of sins that he has put on your life is to do the same for others and then share it is because of Christ. That people will ask, why are you being so kind to me? Why are you forgiving me? Why are you here for me when you have every right to run? You say, and the answer to that is because Christ did that for me. And you get to share Jesus in a natural way with somebody because of the circumstances that surround it. I was just reminded, I ran into a friend of mine. I shouldn't tell you this because I don't want you to take my spot, but it is worth the drive to Parlier to go to that Starbucks instead of Reedley. I'm just going to tell you right now. I'm telling you, that's my spot now. Don't go there because right now nobody's there. And I get my coffee in like 1 minute. Unlike 20 minutes. So it's worth the 10-minute drive to go to Parlier. So I went there, and I met a friend of mine, or a guy I knew in high school. When I was at my darkest times, you know, this person would just pick me up, take me in their car, show me love when I felt like I didn't want to live. And I got to talking with him, and it just reminded me, like, the power of presence is sometimes a great gospel preacher. That you still matter, I am still here, we are all here for you, are some amazing words followed by, because Christ has been there for us. And you get to share the message and the comfort of Christ with somebody when they're in their darkest place. Now, number two is culture crossing, and this is going to be our main focus today. Because we are increasingly in a world in which most people, including in this very room, do not hold the standard opinions or what we might call biblical opinions on or biblical facts about who Christ is, what we believe. There's so many differences, but more and more socially, People don't even have a bearing. I talked about this briefly last week. When we talk about things, I shared this little anecdote last week that from the 1930s to the 1950s, we were going through war. It became really a prominent method to tell people, confess Christ now because you may die and there is a hell. And it was very productive because people were losing family members so quickly that it was make a decision right now. And hell became prominent, but it was there was a fact that even atheists had an understanding of hell and heaven and an afterlife, that 80 to 90% of people believed in something of a afterlife, even if they weren't Christians. Today, that statistic is almost completely the opposite. The vast majority of people don't have a core understanding of eternal life, of judgment. And so the method worked in a certain period of time. Today, you're talking to people with a completely different culture, with a completely different background, a completely different understanding. They are of a different culture. So how do you share Christ in a new context that we're no longer in the 50s? Right? We are in a different place, Toto. So what we see is in chapter 17... In chapter 17 of Acts, it's a pivotal moment in the book of Acts, and it's one of the most famous chapters that is preached. It's Acts 17, Paul goes to the city of Athens, and there's all these philosophers there, and they are doing their thing. They're talking about all these new ideas, all their views on gods and life, and what has meaning and what doesn't, and just doing philosophy. Anybody like philosophy? Yeah, not many. So hang with me today. But that's what he's doing. He meets all these guys, and they're talking about all these ideas. So Paul goes and starts trying to share Jesus in the marketplace. They bring him to this place called the Areopagus. And that's where he can come share about this new religion that they think he's talking about, this new way. And they're like, tell us your ideas. Tell us what's going on. And Paul doesn't take the same method that he did talking to Jews. Last week I shared this. I talked about when Paul was talking to Jews, he spoke about the Messiah because they had some context. They understood what this Messiah was, but when he was talking to Gentiles, he didn't talk about it the same way because they had no context for us. So now this is our greatest example in the book of Acts of him sharing Jesus in a world that didn't have any idea who Jesus was. Now it says this, that when Paul walked into the city. This is a city that would have a plethora of idols. I mean, statues built to all these different gods. There was this great wooden statue of Artemis that would have been like the highlight of the city. And here's what he says. It says that when he walked into the city, Paul was distressed to see that the city was full of idols. He was greatly distressed. Now, I bring this up for this. He was emotional. He was offended, as he should be, that when we see people worshiping things that are not the Creator God, the one that has loved us, given us life and breath, and they make a whole life about worshiping the other things, we should be offended. But Paul didn't respond out of offense. And I think that's got to be a major point. When you go to talk to people, are you responding out of your own insecurity of your faith, out of your own emotion? See, Paul was emotional, as he should be. We should be offended by the things that people put and claim to be God that are not God. But he didn't respond out of that. And that's one of the questions I want to ask. How do you have a conversation with somebody without being emotional? I've been asking my wife that for years. I'm just kidding. How do you have an emotional conversation without being emotional and still being able to share with other people? See, Paul switched approaches from the synagogue to the marketplace, always preaching the same gospel, and the speech he gives at this place serves as an example of how Paul evangelized Gentiles who had virtually no background in the Bible. Now, he's talking to two groups, Epicureans and Stoics. Now, Epicureans were materialists. Let me see if you can listen to this, if it sounds familiar. Or sounds like anything you know today. The Epicureans were materialists. They believed the body and even the soul just dissolves after death. They believed the gods to be totally indifferent to human action. The gods didn't have any interaction with humans. Epicureans neither feared divine judgment nor awaited eternal reward. They didn't think of the afterlife. They enjoyed pleasure and purpose. You only live once, YOLO. And if it feels good, do it, might capture a bit of their spirit. Because it was about how it felt. It was about this life. It was materialism. And so Paul's got one side of this that are heavily Epicurean, and then he's got the other side that are Stoics. Now, Stoics were like our New Agers a little bit. They were pantheists. They believed God was in everything, that God was in every part of the world. They really thought of a world soul, that the divinity was in every person and every living thing. They confused God with every physical attribute in the world and thought the world was determined by fate. So they didn't believe that God was intervening. Everything was divine. There is a famous biblical author who says this. He says, to oversimplify, it was characteristic of Epicureans to emphasize chance, escape, and the enjoyment of pleasure, and of the Stoics to emphasize fatalism, submission, and endurance to pain. In other words, one group said, if it feels good, do it. There are no consequences. While the other group said, grin and bear it. There's nothing you can do about it anyway. Do these sound familiar? There's a fatedness. There's a pleasure seeking. This is the world we live in. Like, there is nothing more. You only live once. Do what you feel. Be what you feel. There is nothing greater. But see, there's always a greater question behind all of this. And I believe this is the question every single one of you and every person in the world is asking. Does anything we do, this is philosophy for those who don't like philosophy. These are the questions we ask even if you aren't in a philosophy class. Does anything we do matter? Does everything I do matter? Do I matter? Is there any importance to my daily life? Am I just a physical thing that's going to die and pass away? Do my actions have consequences? Are they already predetermined? Do I have choice? See, deep down, most of us live our lives by these questions without even thinking about them. We work hard to make our lives matter. We strive to find somebody to love us to make our lives matter. See, you don't have to be in philosophy books to be asking the same questions. And you know what I love about Paul? Is Paul doesn't actually go to the Old Testament scriptures because they didn't know him. He actually doesn't talk about hell. One thing that was surprising to some of you last week is the book of Acts talks about judgment, which we're going to talk about today, but never mentions hell, mostly because they're talking to Gentiles who don't have a basis for what he's speaking about. But I did make the caveat that Jesus talks about hell a lot. So why? What shifts between Luke and Acts? So Paul approaches these philosophers, and he uses their method of argumentation, and he does it with this. It's called ethos, logos, and pathos. He starts with the ethos. The ethos is, what do we all have in common? I want to find a commonality, and this is important. This is instructive. This isn't as passionate of a preach as I might give you other times. This is a little more thinking through this stuff, because I want you to think about, how do I approach somebody? Most of us do not feel equipped to know the Word of God, and that's something we need to work on, but we don't feel equipped to be able to share it adequately. So how do you go about it? Paul starts here. He starts with this ethos. It's getting the person you're talking to trust you. What do we share in common? So this is what he says. He finds commonality. He finds what desires and values they share. It says in verse 19 that he came to the Areopagus, and they asked him, may we know this new teaching that you are presenting? And he says, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, Here was the thing that he was pointing out. He's not actually blasting them here. He's acknowledging that everybody is religious. They are all worshipers. They just don't yet worship Jesus. He says, I've walked around. I've seen that you worship all these things. Now, here's the thing about this culture. This culture had so many gods because they were really just trying to figure out how to not be insecure, in my opinion. They would have a god of sex, a god of money, a god of agriculture. And then they had this inscription on one called the Unknown God. And he says, I even see a statue in that you worship called that says to the Unknown God. And you want to know why they're doing that? Because they're like, well, if we missed any, this one might cover us. If there's anything that will not leave us in despair or not bless us, we'll pray to this one. It's like a crapshoot. It's like Vegas for Jesus or gods, you know? It's like, you know, and so he's like, I see that you're super religious. Now, how does that apply today? One of the fundamental points, which I can't get into today, but you have to understand, is one way to talk to people is help them see that as much as they hate religion and hate your religion, we all actually hold the same religious views about things. We find things that say you have worth, this is the means to salvation. Do you know that even our secular culture believes in sin, they just don't use that word. All you got to do is find out what really offends them that there is no forgiveness for. And we got a lot of those, don't we? What are the things that really offend you that you're like, that person is so awful that they don't even deserve my forgiveness? We got a culture full of that. They just don't use the word sin. So the way you help talk to them is you go, man, I see that you and I share the same values. I'm offended by things too that I think are awful. And some of those things you're offended by, I'm offended by. And what's amazing about Paul is, and I'll talk about this in a little bit, but he actually quotes their philosophers and poets. At the end of this speech, if you read through it in Acts 17, he quotes their philosophers, not believers. He quotes their poets. I think it's amazing. I try that when I quote, like, you know, songs from Tupac. I got in trouble for that one here. I'm like, I'm culture crossing. But that's what he does. He knows their philosophers. He knows their poets, and he uses it in his speech to connect it to Jesus. See, he's not just saying everything you think is wrong, and I don't know anything about you, but I know what's right. He's like, no, I know your stuff, and you know the stuff that you think that your own poets and philosophers said? I can tell you who that's about. It's about Jesus. And then verse 17 in chapter 17 of Acts says that Paul reasoned with the people. Rather than allowing his feelings to lead him to angrily respond with all these attacks on them, he listened to and heard them. He dialogued with them and debated with them. The thing about Paul's approach is it had gentleness and confrontation. He had gentleness and compassion and confrontation. And we talked about that last week. And at the end of this, I hope to at least point out how you can approach people with compassion and confrontation. How you can have a conversation without being easily offended. Paul reasoned from the scriptures. When Paul was talking to Jewish believers, he reasoned from the scriptures, explaining that Jesus was the Messiah talked about, because that's what they believed. But for those unfamiliar with scripture, Paul reasoned from creation. He connected it to things that they understood. Paul recognized that the biblical illiteracy of the Athenians did not allow him to speak in the same manner as he did to those who already knew about God in the synagogues. See, we often try to talk at people, and the reality is I know most of you are like, I don't talk to people about it, period. That's the statistic. It's probably true. But this even matters to you, because if you're ever going to take the command of Jesus to go witness to your faith seriously, you also have to address why it's so awkward for you. And one of those is because we often watch people go up and just hit people over the head. And we say things like, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says. Well, guys, I got to tell you now, in this world, you're talking to a group of people who have no bearing, no background in the Bible. You're saying the Bible says, and they don't know the Bible, believe the Bible, or find it worthwhile. Do you understand what I'm saying? It is the Word of God. It is the authoritative Word of God, but the people you're talking to don't see it as such. There is a Bible commentator named Dr. Tony Merida, and he says this. He says, simply telling someone Jesus loves you and died for you, so make him Lord of your life and be forgiven for your sins, is confusing and even alienating to those who can't define sin and don't understand who Jesus is or what his death has to do with anything. I want you to look at those words. You've heard them in church. They become common to you. They make sense for some reason to you. But think about, try to imagine yourself as a person who's never been raised in church or has had awful, low-level experiences in church. And people go, Jesus loved you and died for you. Why? Well, for your sins. What? What sins? What? I don't even have a context for sin. So he can be Lord of your life. What? What do you mean? I don't have a Lord or a King. So you can be forgiven. Of what? It's confusing. Because you're using language for people that have been raised in it. Now, I tell you, like, yes, culturally, decades ago, there were even people who didn't believe had these fundamental understandings of things. It was enculturated into their families, into their way of life. They understood them. They don't today. We don't today even. So Paul starts with meeting them where they're at. Hey, let me tell you about the God who created all things. You worship all these gods. He goes, I see that you are religious, and I'm religious too. And today I would say the opposite of that is, you don't like that I'm religious, but let me show you how we are all religious. We all give ourselves to things that we think are going to save us. We all get really angry and pissed about things that we think are going to hurt us or hurt people we love or take something from our freedoms, right? There is sin, and we all devote our whole lives to things that we think will bring us worth. Life. Man, we're religious people, and I see that in you. And man, that's great. But let me tell you, you're missing the one that really brings this about. He says, let me tell you about this unknown God. This isn't a crapshoot anymore. Like, there is a God who answers you. Now, the second part, I said, that's ethos. Let's establish something we have in common. The second part is the logos. This is the rational part. All right, I'm filtering jokes right now, so I just want everybody to know. This is the rational part. The logos, it's getting people to think. Is what we are desiring really coming about? Every one of you, whether you're a strong believer, a non-believer, whatever, you have a belief in your life that if I do things this way, it will make me happy. If I do things, if I get this, it will make me fulfilled. If I don't do this, I will miss out on something. I will not have worth. And yet, if you play your life out and you really think through it, is what you believe and what you give your life to really turning out the way you thought it would? See, there's a rationality to this. If you say, I'm not really into God, I'm into work, is work providing everything you want? If you say, man, I'm trying to find my identity in money and sex and whatever it is, are you really happier? It's starting to question the inconsistency of the beliefs in a loving way with those who sit with you and struggle with God. See, this is what Paul says. I even found an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very things you worship. And this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. He says, I'm going to give you this good news. See, what Paul points out is underneath every sin problem, every relational problem, every intellectual problem, there's actually a worship problem. Paul is like, you don't even know what you're worshiping, but you're worshiping. You know, if I put my whole life into my love life, and I'm like, man, I need to find somebody who's going to just fulfill every sinew, who every part of me that's insecure and feels like I'm not enough, man, if I could just get sex and love and attention, then, man, I will be so filled. I will just know my identity. I'll just be so myself. I'll finally reach this euphoria, this place of feeling good. And then you follow it going, okay, I had it. I had somebody, either they hurt me or they didn't, but it wasn't enough, and now I want more. And you go, did it really reach the end result you wanted, or are you still just as struggling, anxious, depressed as you were prior to getting everything you wanted? You point out that there you are worshiping something, and it is failing to provide. See, we don't worship gods and wooden idols per se, you don't think of them as such, but we worship 1,000 things in this world. You, Christian, even worship other things than God. You worship politics. You worship money. You worship success. And you begin to ask those questions, are these things I gave my life to actually paying off what I thought they would? Are they making me more whole? I hated religion, and yet is this other world that I'm chasing, is it making things better? Paul does that. He just asks those questions. And he goes on to tell him, he goes, God is not served by human hands. And I'm going to tell you why this is important culturally. He says, God is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their land. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out to him and find them, though he is not far from any of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. He says he's created all these things, but here's the point. God is not served by human hands. Every god that these people serve, these Athenians, these Epicureans, these Stoics, they required you to act, to give, to produce, to sacrifice, and maybe, just maybe, they'll have good graces on you. It was just this luck. It was like praying. It's throwing stuff up and hoping that they'll be happy with you. And if they're happy with you, maybe they'll give you a baby and some money and good agricultural years or whatever it is. It's just, please don't be angry at me. Don't smite me. And he goes, God is not served by your human hands. Here's the tie to today. How many people do you talk to that they are just throwing themselves at things, hoping, just hoping life doesn't fall apart on them and that they bless them, that it works and that they'll be happy in this fear and trepidation? He goes, hey, you have a God who doesn't require you to appease him. You don't have to dance around to try to make him happy and hope he doesn't just like smite you one day. You have a God who has loved you, that loves you regardless, that has marked out, that has planned the universe, that he has planned history. And it is in him that you already live and have your own being. He is the whole reason you live. So we point out, how has your beliefs of what you believe will bring you worth, how has that played out for you? Are you healthier? The thing you give your life to, the thing you worship, the thing you hope, if I could just get enough of that, I'll be good. Are you happier? How's that working for your kids? How's that working for your spouse? How's that working in your life? And you do it with love. And you do it with compassion. And you know how you have compassion? Because you and I all worship things that are not God that destroy us. And you go, wow, I know what it's like to yearn for something that never puts out enough. One of the fundamental rules I hope that will stick with you today is this. Multiplying gods multiplies sorrows. Work from this assumption that people who are worshiping, including yourself, anybody who gives their life, their time, their devotion, and hopes to anything other than Jesus Christ will eventually have increasing sorrows, heartache, health consequences, losses, depression, anxiety. All will be a sign in you and I and others that we have gods that we have given our life over to, that our whole hope is in appeasing and dancing for and hoping they just will be happy and fulfill us. And they fail to do it. They increase our sorrows. And if we work from that premise, then you can ask loving questions about how is this playing out, this worship of anything but God? And then Paul brings it to the pathos. It's getting people to feel. It's pointing to Jesus as the consummation. So you find commonality. Here's what we share in common, y'all. like, man, I see you. I see that you got things you believe and hope in, things that are sin to you. And man, I get it. Things that you don't call sin, but man, they are ultimate. You believe they are ultimately wrong and unjust in the world. And then you question the inconsistency of maybe their beliefs. Man, you believe that if we could just get this right political thing in place, that everything will be right. Can you walk me through the last, like, I don't know, 500 years? Has that worked out? Everything gone swell every time you got your way? No. There's inconsistency in my hopes. So let me point to Jesus as the consummation. Now, what does consummation mean? Consummation is the ultimate end. It's the completion of a goal. It's a fulfillment of a desire or a desired outcome. That means Jesus is the only one who can fulfill this thing we're all after. That's the answer. That's how I point to him. So here's what Paul says. He says in verse 17, he says, therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof to this by everyone by raising him from the dead. He says, this Jesus, he goes, you guys don't believe in judgment. And you know what? Half of you in this room statistically probably don't believe in much in a judgment. And the world definitely doesn't believe in a divine, eternal judgment, the world we live in today. Okay? He says, there is a judge, but don't, I'm going to give you an example of why you all do believe in judgment. You just don't like the idea of God being judge. Okay? But he says, there is a judge, and there's only one. You are not judged by all these other gods and all these other people. There is nothing that can tell you you have no worth or you're no good or you're great. There is nothing that can do that for you. There's only one judge. And he will bring justice. He will make things right. He will bring rightness in the world at the appointed time. And he's proven that he is this God because he didn't just die for your sins. We believe he didn't just metaphorically raise from the dead to give you an idea that you can overcome your struggles. He literally, physically, bodily rose from the dead. And because that, it shows that God brings new life. And if there is only one that can judge your life, it is the one who is able to create life, end life, and restore life. So if you remember, I said you got two groups. You got the group that says, if it feels good, do it. There are no consequences. And you got the other group, grin and bear it. There's nothing you can do about it anyway. Life sucks. And then you die. And against both of these philosophies, Paul's speech affirms that there is a resurrection, that life matters, that there is a future judgment, and there is a purpose to human history. So he says, repent. Now, that might strike a chord in some of you who have been told and yelled at with hellfire and brimstone, but he's just saying, turn away from all these things that fail to ever meet what you thought they would meet. Just take a moment and walk through your history and think of everything you're like, man, if I just get that job, everything going smooth? Man, if I just get that girl, come on now. We all know and we keep doing it. It just gets worse, unless you're married to my wife. I'm the only exception to the rule. No, but when you put your whole hopes, you can just walk through your history and he goes, no, man, there is just repent. Turn from that stuff that continues to let you down to the one that can create life, end life, and resurrect life. Now, I'm going to give you an example of one of my favorite arguments. Actually, yeah. It's about judgment, because I, too, am one of those sissies that doesn't like the idea of talking about judgment with people. It's uncomfortable. I get no pleasure in it. That one day you and I stand before God judged, because we already have these bad ideas that he's going to unroll a scroll and go, remember 10 years ago, you know? And you're just like, dang, my list is long. I got ADHD. You know, that's not what it's talking about. It's talking about making things righteous and right and just. And so how do you meet a world to talk about judgment that doesn't believe in a divine judgment? You point out that they actually don't have a problem with judgment. They don't like God judging, but maybe let's get to the heart of this. Maybe they would if they stopped thinking about it as this long list of good people and just hearing all the bad things they've done. For instance, let me give you an example. Judgment is ingrained in us. The desire for judgment is ingrained in us. It means that what you do matters. What you do is filled with meaning, and what you do will be weighed. Remove judgment, and there is no meaning to what you do. Remove a measure, and you have nothing that has any bearing. It's not filled with meaning. It is measured. Think about anything that you succeed in. If nobody measures it, you have no idea how you did. You have no idea the meaning behind it. But I want you to think of cases of judgment here. Two ways of thinking about this. Number one, I want you to picture a child rapist. And I bring up this extreme example because it gets to the heart of everyone. And you go, gross, awful, disgusting. And they go to court. We believe in judgment. We believe that 12 random people, half of us are like trying to get out of it, are going to make righteous judgments of what happens to this person. We believe that the system should be just. And here's what I'm going to say. The American system is probably one of the most balanced ways of doing civil cases against crime and problems, but yet we get it wrong. And sometimes there are people that are child rapists who get off. And they don't get convicted. And what does that do inside of you when you know? This guy is walking around. He has hurt tons of people. And our system just let him go. They just said, you know what? You said some nice things. Just go. What does that do here? What does it do? See, I don't care if you're a liberal, conservative. I don't care what you are. At that situation, make it about your family. You'll say, I need justice. There needs to be justice. And they'll go, well, he said he was sorry. And he was really kind to almost everybody. All his neighbors said he was a good person. And you go, no. Like, there needs to be rightness. And you feel it when things are wrong. And then there's the other side. Anybody have watched those videos? There are 2020s of the people who have been in prison for 20 years to finally have DNA exonerate them. And you go, this man was thrown in prison. How many videos of black men getting thrown in prison in the 1950s, 60s, 70s are now being exonerated, and they spent their whole lives taken from them because of racism, because of a lack of DNA and evidence, and we're finding out about them now. What does that do to you? Where you go, how can that be just? How can that be right? How can you ever make this right? You took 30, 40 years from somebody. How can you throw a person in hell for nothing? See, you have a righteous fiber in your being. You know what I believe about Jesus and judgment? Is that I serve a fair, loving, and perfectly just God. I don't know how it works, but I believe he will be better than my court system here in America. I believe that when everything is against a person, like a criminal on a cross, it says everything he deserves is punishment, that he sees innocence on that person. And I believe for people who get away scot-free, hurting people, stealing from people, or enriching themselves at the expense of the poor, that God looks and knows in perfect judgment what has gone on and what has transpired, and that he is more perfectly fair than anything we could hope or imagine. And you know what he says? The Bible teaches us that God is not like our courts. God is a perfect judge. It actually tells us that he is our advocate. He is our lawyer, by its technical term, and he is our judge. God himself is the judge and the lawyer. So on one end, he holds you to this perfect standard where he says, I see everything you've done. And then at the same time, in Jesus Christ, it says that he is your lawyer. And he goes, no, let me show you. He's innocent. Talk to me. I've made him innocent. That God himself is both the judge and the divine forgiveness that stands between you and the long laundry list you fear you have to stand in front of. That's the cross that we see. In the cross, it is a perfect example. It is judgment for the sins of the world. His death is proof that there is injustice. A perfect man. God shows judgment in its perfect form, that a perfect man is sentenced to death. And that, if we see it in real life, it makes us just squirm in our seats. That a good man, a decent man, would be thrown into prison or given a death sentence. But the Bible elevates Jesus to the perfect man being given a death sentence. It tells us that the great injustice of the world, that the sin of the world, this is what it does. And then his resurrection tells us that we have a God so powerful that he makes everything new and right. That when things are consummated, when things come to their completion, everything will be justified, made right, and perfect. And that we can hope for that. If you don't believe in God because you don't like a God of judgment, what are you going to do when that child rapist got to make millions of dollars and never get convicted? Right? You just got to accept fadedness? That's just the world. No, the thing inside of you churns. Things need to be made right. And Jesus says, I make all things right, all things new. There is justice. And the perfect judge is the only one who can see to it. I use that because we have to ask those questions to people. This is a popular one to use because people hate the God of the Bible who judges. But if they really were put in the crosshairs of these questions, I think all of us can agree and find a common point of that. No, there has to be justness. There has to be justice for the oppressed, for the neglected. Right? And see, we have to keep the cross as our central focus and worldview. If you're a Christian, this is how you talk about it. You have to understand the cross. If you don't accept the cross as your worldview, then you'll either be too accepting or too demanding. When you constantly understand that the cross both examines you in judgment and redeems you as a lawyer, as an advocate, then you can share with people Jesus, a Jesus with boldness and compassion. You are neither looking down on them as if they are worse than you, nor are you afraid to talk about it, because you realize this actually isn't a wrong thing to talk about. Everybody's searching for this somehow. We just got to think about the words that we're using in a way that connects to people and helps them understand that God is the answer. Jesus is the consummation to all these deep-seated questions people have. I'm going to briefly tell you the last point as I close. So we've talked about you comfort people. You cross cultures with people. You listen to them. You learn from them. You know they're poets. You know what they feel and think. You sympathize. You have ethos with them. There's connection. And you keep discussing and dialoguing like Paul. When do you concede and go, I'm done trying? There's a big question. And it tells us in chapter 18, after this whole episode where Paul talks to those at the Areopagus. And let me tell you the end result of that. A lot of them say, oh, you're an idiot. But there are a number of people, including a person of importance who was a philosopher on that, within that group, who join Christ as a disciple. Because they heard the rationality of God, not just a message of, let me tell you about the Bible says and you're going to hell, but a reasoned, well thought out understanding of how Jesus is the answer to the things these people are searching for. But then he goes to this next town and he tries to talk to Jews again, the religious people. He goes to their synagogues over and over again, trying to share about Jesus as the Messiah. He's now switched gears, going back to the Old Testament, going back to the Messiah. It says, but when they opposed Paul and became abusive, he shook out his clothes in protest and said, your blood be on your heads. I am innocent of it. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles. When people become abusive to God's name or to you, you stop. And I will add this. When people go, hey, can you please stop saying that to me? You respect them. You respect them. But here's the reality. As Paul said in chapter 17, this God is the God who created all things and organized history towards its end. He is the one who is the perfect judge, who knows all things. You leave it in his hands. You dust your hands off and you go, hey, your life is on God's, in God's hands. When it becomes abusive, when people become derogatory to Jesus himself or become abusive to you because of your faith, you concede. God, do what you will. Lord, I pray for them. Lord, they are in your hands. And you have trust, going back to the God of justice, the God of righteousness, that the God of justice and righteousness will determine the course of all things for this person's life in due time. Now, I want to leave you with this. This is the challenge today. You guys, this sermon was hard for me because I know that most people don't care about this. This isn't like your daily issue in your life. And that's hard because I want it to connect. I want it to make sense to you, like, I want it to matter to your daily life, and most of us aren't walking around going, how do I share my faith better? But you should. If you say, I follow Jesus, he commands you to tell people about the hope that is in you. He tells you that he is the only means to the brokenness in our lives, to the salvation in our lives, to eternal life. And he says, you are to be my witnesses, to proclaim, to share good news with others. It doesn't have to look like the awful ways you saw it for so many years in our world. It doesn't have to be the people putting down others. Sometimes you can be rational and loving and compassionate, but you do it nonetheless. So how do you get to this place? Most of us will look at this and go, well, I'm no Paul. That guy's pretty bright. I read Cosmopolitan, and you'd be right. That would make it harder. But we start. How do you share your faith well? You have been commanded by Jesus Christ, if you claim him to be Lord and Savior, to share about him. How do you do it well? First, learn and listen better. I challenge you, this is why we have Bible studies. This is why we come to church. And I'm not trying to put anybody down, but come consistently. We talk about the scriptures and we go in depth. Make it a part of your life to read and learn, to understand how Jesus is the consummation of your life. How on every issue, it might sound like we preach the same thing every week because we do, but we do it in shades. There's one gospel. There's one gospel. And that's the gospel I share every week. But we look at it from every angle of human experience. And how Jesus meets you there. And the more you get that, how one gospel can meet 1,000 people in 1,000 eras, in 1,000 different lands, in 1,000 needs, in so many different ways, you begin to learn ways to talk about it. So read the scriptures. I'm also going to give you a book that I love called The Reason for God. Write it down, read it. It's called The Reason for God. It'll bring you the hardest issues in this society that we live in Western society. All the hot topics, all the fun ones, hell, sex, judgment. Yeah, all the fun stuff. It's like it's better than Cosmopolitan. It's got all that stuff except hell. But the Reason for God looks at it and gives you rational, reasonable ways to understand how Jesus is the answer to these things that people have struggles with. Not going around going, you're stupid that you don't believe in Jesus or that you think that. It's going, no, you know why you think that? It's because there's this unknown God, and let me tell you who he is. You're missing it, that he is the answer to what you're looking for. If you believe in justice, then there's a God of justice. If you believe in truly finding your identity, there's a God who is the one who made your identity. Right? So The Reason for God, read it. Secondly, you got to make a practice in your prayer life to reflect on that cross. To sit there and go, man, God has both judged me and saved me and redeemed me. That God is both my judge and counselor and my advocate. That the cross says that the world is wildly unjust and there is only one thing in my life that brings new life and redemption, and I can stop chasing all this other crap. You got to do it first. How are you going to tell anybody about the hope of Christ if he hasn't been your answer? Let him be your answer, and it will come a lot naturally to how you share about what God's doing. Keep serving other gods while going to church. And yeah, you're right. You're going to have a hard time talking to people about how he's the answer to the problems of the world. You're just living in them. He is. And lastly, that's the last point, similar. Resolve how Jesus is the true fulfillment of your desires. You start with all the things you're chasing. How's that working for you, friends? Your work, your money, you keep working out? You happy? I know the data. Pew Research tells me you're not happy. If you know that, it's time to figure out how Jesus is the fulfillment of all the stuff that I'm after that continues to leave me wanting. And when you get that, it's a lot easier to share your faith with people because you start with this conversation. Man, I had this, this, and this, or I went through this, this, and this, and everything I did failed to provide. But there is one, Jehovah Jireh, the God who is a provider that has provided on every single thing that I've been after in my life. Do you have a provider that provides every area, just like the Athenians? Man, we have a God of agriculture, a God of sex, a God of romance. We got a God of money. And we just spend our whole day anxious that they're just going to kick us one day because we didn't put enough fragrance into our offering. And Paul says, there is one God who covers all this, and you don't have to appease him. Just love him, know him. Follow him, and he will provide all things to the end of time with perfect justice. Okay. My challenge to you is examine those gods in your life. How's that working for you? Let them go and give your full devotion. He says, I see that you're all religious. Don't ever believe you're not religious. You are. You could care less what I'm saying right now, and you're religious. Because you have given your life to something you think is going to give you meaning. And I'm telling you, it will not turn out. Because there's only one who can provide that type of eternal life, that type of meaning, that type of purpose. Jesus Christ. Amen? If you'll pray with me. Lord God, I just thank you for this time together. Lord, I just pray that we begin to experience you. For those who are believers, I pray that we begin to experience you in ways that we begin to see how you are the fulfillment of our lost dreams, how you are the fulfillment of our emptiness, how you are the fulfillment of our anxiety and the remover of it. You are the fulfillment of our hope, of our families, of our children. Lord God, may we give you that devotion in full faith and full trust that nothing else will do. Thank you for being Jehovah Jireh, for being the provider of every single thing in our life. Lord, for those who have not discovered Christ, don't know Christ like that, I pray for them, Lord, with compassion and love, Lord, that you would nudge them, love them, Lord, that whatever they're sitting in, that they would reveal the emptiness of the chasing of this world, that they would give you a shot, that they would draw near, that they would attune their ears just to say, okay, I want to try. I want to try this God out who says he provides all things. And Lord, for the believer, Lord, I just pray that you would stir us to draw nearer, to know your word, to know your gospel so well that we could just share with people with this love and compassion at the right place, at the right time, with the right tone. To just love people where they're at and give them the gospel in its, that one gospel in its many shades. Can see that in so many ways your gospel intersects every single person's life, no matter where they are born, when they were born, or where they are born. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Go out and give them heaven.